Welcome to a virtual town hall meeting where tonight Senator Bill Stachowski will update you on the budget, what it means to you, and the future of New York. I'm Julia Locandy, the moderator this evening. Senator Stachowski is the Senate Chairman of Commerce, Economic Development, and Small Business. He knows that there are many of you out there who have new ideas and questions about the 2010-2011 state budget. The senator is going to be taking your questions live right here, right now. So if you haven't already, email them to us at StachowskiTownHall@gmail.com. Or if you're tweeting your questions, use the hashtag, which is the number symbol, StachowskiTownHall. And anyone using a telephone to call in your question can do so at 800-930-9964. It's great to be here with you, Senator. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. It's nice to be here with you, and it's great to give an opportunity to people in the district, as well as outside the district, obviously, a chance to give us some of their concerns about this year's budget.
Yeah, what are your expectations for tonight?
Well, we're hoping to get some questions that maybe will give us some direction on things that people are interested in. We've been holding roundtables on economic development already in parts of the state and got some ideas from those. And we constantly get letters and calls from people on various parts of the budget, so it's interesting to see what the people in the district feel about the budget as opposed to just what we think.
All right. The senator is committed to develop strategies to grow the economy by creating new jobs in New York. And on top of this virtual forum, like he said, the senator has been giving concerned citizens and field experts the opportunity to prioritize investments for New York by hosting roundtable discussions across the state. So I want to start with Buffalo, because I know that you had one there. How was that?
The roundtable in Buffalo went very well. We had not only a group of small business people. We also had a couple of large companies. We had some people that do direct assistance with what is called a SPUR, a strategic planning industrial resource. It's a part of the University of Buffalo. It combines their School of Management and their School of Engineering, and they work with local businesses and helping them with their business plans and how to bring their businesses more into being more profitable and maximizing their abilities.
Right. And you also were in Syracuse.
We were in Syracuse on Friday morning and had another group of people made up of academics, and also we had the representatives of the Business Council were there. Again, some small business people. We had representatives of agribusiness there. Burn Dairy was there. And we also had some business people that would tell us what they thought worked, what they thought didn't work, where our gaps are in economic development, and how we could better utilize our programs in the future in making them more efficient in delivering money to small businesses and large businesses so they can create jobs and stay in New York.
Right, and you also held a roundtable in Watertown.
We went up to Watertown. Senator Albertine asked if we could bring one up to his district. Watertown is in one of the northernmost areas, and that Senator Albertine's district is up north. It's well known for its snow in the winter, so we're a little nervous about it, but it was a beautiful day, and we had good participation. We also had people from the Adirondacks area, which they call below the blue line. They have really specific situations that they have to deal with that other businesses don't, mainly caused by the presence of the Adirondack Park there and the different rules and regulations that the Adirondack Park have, and since they are in it, their businesses have to go through some different regulations, so we're trying to find a way to help them specifically with their problems in developing their businesses and helping them to grow.
So you talked about the differences there. Do you hear a lot of the same things?
In some of the areas we do, because part of the reason we were traveling was there's currently the Empire Zone program, which is supposed to sunset this year. And the governor in his budget has put out the Excelsior Job program, and it's a little bit different than Empire Zone. So we were asking the companies what they thought of both, what they thought the shortcomings of both were, and what they thought we could do to maximize our bang for our dollar. And plus, there's some new things in the budget this year. There's a small business loan fund. There's a venture capital fund. There's funding for what the people in the biotech and emerging industries call getting them through the valley of death. It's that area from when they first are established and before they can get out on their own and grow successfully. There's a portion of time that they call the valley of death in their business, and there's a fund to help them deal with that, and we just want to make sure that these funds are the best they can be and easiest to utilize. And that's the other part of the question was, how can we make it easier to do business in New York?
Right. And is there a plan for that?
And there is a big section in the budget called Mandate Relief, and we're going to try to make sure that some of these business problems are included in that. And the governor's looking at establishing a one-stop shopping, so to speak, location where people can apply for things on the internet. And it would be easier, it would be less time consuming, and the back and forth could be a lot faster.
Yeah, so cut out the red tape and bureaucracy.
And cut out a lot of the paperwork.
Yeah. Okay, so do you want to get down to some questions that people are
coming? I'll be happy to take some questions.
All right, great. There were two questions that came in, one of the first two questions today, and they both referred to an article in the Buffalo News this Sunday about the UB 2020 plan. The first email was from the writer of that article, and he said, how can Senator Stachowski sponsor the UB 2020 Flexibility and Economic Growth Act when it will hurt low and middle income families trying to send their kids to college, not to mention adversely impact minorities?
Now, I don't want to say that the writer of that, and I read the article, and I just think he has a mindset that it's a bad situation that we would be in if we did UB 2020. On the opposite view, I think it's a great situation. I don't think we will price low-income families out of it, because part of the new tuition policy, first of all, we're going to try to have a rational tuition, which means that when people come into school, they know pretty much what it's going to cost them and what any potential increase would be. Secondly, if given that policy in the UB 2020 bill, there's 20% of the money from the tuition increase would be set aside for a fund that would make sure nobody was not allowed to go to school or take a certain course or finish their education because of a lack of finances. That fund would provide the finances to make sure that student can attend UB and they wouldn't be turned away just because they didn't have enough money.
Okay, and another one came in by the phone, and the person said, I thought there were some pretty compelling arguments about how the UB 2020 plan is not necessarily a good idea for the university, for Western New York, and New York taxpayers in general. So my question to Senator Stachowski is, why has he been such a strong supporter of UB 2020, and does he feel like it's a realistic plan for not only making UB a top-notch public research university, but does he also feel that it is the kind of plan that could lift up the local economy in Western New York, and if so, how?
Okay, first of all, it's not just I that feel that way. University of Buffalo took a study that was put out by SUNY, and 5 years ago they put that study out. They took it, and 2 years they worked on it to put together the legislation. We then went to work with them on the legislation, and what the legislation does, and for some reason the writer, and he's a terrific writer, the article was very well written. He's obviously an academic, and the fact about UB 2020, though, is this. The business community supports it. The union people support it. They have a long, long list of UB supporters that they've gathered by doing various presentations throughout Western New York on UB 2020. And at a time when the state doesn't have money to give higher education, it couldn't come at a better time, because without giving them more money, we're going to let the university grow. And how are we going to do that? One, we're going to let them keep the tuition that they collect. Up until now, there was never a guarantee that the tuition raises went back to the university sites. Now, when the tuition is raised at a university, it will go back to them. That's one. And then, as we mentioned already, there's a pot of money to make sure nobody will be left behind because of some financial problem they would have in attending if they were qualified to get in. Second thing it does, it lets them set up public-private partnerships. Public-private partnerships are already allowed in a lot of places, and they're allowed in CUNY, and they're also allowed in different places in upstate. At the Nanotech College, they have public-private partnerships. So they are already doing it in some places. We think that it would be a great opportunity for Buffalo to do it. As a matter of fact, the vascular hospital that they're building in Buffalo is a public-private partnership between the University of Buffalo and Kaleida Health System. It can be possibly one of the best medical centers in the United States when it's finished, because not only will it have all the vascular practices in one place, it will also have one floor for entrepreneurial and one floor for research and development. Something that's unheard of now, but would be all in one place and a terrific opportunity for Western New York. The leasing and selling of land. Right now, CUNY can lease and sell their property. SUNY can't. This would help University of Buffalo, and there's oversight because the Board of Trustees has to okay any lease or selling of any property that UB plans on doing. So there's oversight by the university system on that particular area. So in every part of this package, there's oversight or it's done someplace else. It's a win-win for the university. It's a win-win for Buffalo. It'll enable them to grow. The argument that they're going to not hire full-time professors, in order to be a top-notch research institution, you have to have full tenured professors and quality professors, and you also have to have a low student to professor ratio to get a higher ranking. Because when these, for example, when U.S. Business Review, when they have their college review and their university review, one of the things they rated on is that. So they have a plan that when the university grows, also the number of professors, full-time accredited professors will be, tenured professors, excuse me, will grow with it. And so it's a win-win for the university professors too, and for some reason that seems to be getting lost in this argument. So we think it's a great program for the university. I know that there's the business community in Buffalo is fully behind it. They believe it's a good plan. Some people say, well, it has numbers that are grandiose, but the study was done using well-accepted tools to do this kind of study, and it was done by a reputable center, and they came up with the numbers that are used in the report on UB 2020. So we think it's pretty accurate. We think it meets the goals that they say it'll meet, and it'll let the university grow, and by growing, it'll take the whole community up with it.
All right, so let's take a look at what some other people are asking you. There seems to be a lot of people concerned with the sugary beverage tax. So do you want to tell us whether you support it or not?
Well, right now I'm not in support of the sugary beverage tax. One of the things that the governor had said up until he released his budget was we weren't going to do any new taxes. And to have this tax and say, the reason I have this tax is it's going to fight obesity and diabetes, I have difficulty with that. I have difficulty in this respect. That tax is going on any beverage that's made with a syrup that has sugar in it. So, for example, it's not just Diet Coke and Diet Pepsi and Diet whatever other soda you happen to drink. It's also Gatorade, it's juices, it's everything with sugar in it. And it's a penny an ounce. So a 20-ounce bottle of Gatorade will now cost a person 20 cents more. Or a 20-ounce bottle of Powerade will cost that person 20 cents more. And then a six-pack of soda, you multiply the size of the bottle times six, and that's how much more it's going to cost you. And I believe that not only will that happen, but because they won't differentiate, even the sodas without sugar in them will go up the same price. So that for the middle-class, hardworking people in my district, that maybe want to have a bottle of soda at the end of the day, not necessarily a child that's going to become obese, but the average adult that says, I want to have a glass of soda at the end of the day, it's going to be a more expensive for them. They don't have a lot of loose money to keep meeting all these increases that we come up with, because in the name of health care, we're going to be putting a tax on every sugary beverage. Now we have the other problem here, is that for restaurants, for example, that serve their soda with guns, they got to keep track every time they use a sugary soda. So they have to charge a penny an ounce of the amount they pour, and they have to collect all that. Otherwise, they're subject to some sales tax problems, which get quite expensive, not only for the lawyer, but also for the fine that they'll go after you with. And now that goes to the fact that if you're drinking a highball, a screwdriver, rum and Coke, you have to keep track of the soda that's involved in that drink. You can't just charge what the drink was in this normal sales tax. You have to add an extra penny for every ounce of that sugary beverage that's included in it.
And this doesn't apply to diet drinks, correct?
Well, it doesn't apply to diet drinks, but you know that when they sell a 12-pack of Diet Coke, they're going to probably end up charging you the same thing they're charging you for a 12-pack of Coca-Cola.
And what do you say to the fact that people say that it will prevent obesity?
Well, in and by itself, it won't, because it's more than just drinking soda that's causing people to be obese. It's the way they eat, the way they either exercise or don't exercise, and there's a lot more things that are taken into the body than just soda that cause obesity.
Right. Right, and there's a lot of chemicals in diet drinks that aren't good for you.
And if you take it to the people at the cancer hospitals, they'll tell you if you exercise, you're better off drinking that sugary drink than you are drinking that diet drink because it doesn't have the chemicals that are involved in the diet drink.
So are you hearing that from a lot of your constituents about the soda tax?
I'm not hearing a lot of support for the soda tax in my area. Interestingly enough, schools have already taken soda out of the school day. As far as taking care of the drinking patterns of students during the school day, soda's not available to them at the schools. Different other drinks are available to them at the schools. Part of that's already being handled, and to add a tax on soda just because we're going to stop anybody from drinking it, I don't know that that's going to accomplish it. It's going to just make things more expensive for the working men and women in the state of New York, and right now I don't know that we need to do a lot of things that are going to make things more expensive for them.
Okay, so, education is a big part of the budget, this year's budget. What do you think, how can you make that fair?
Well, we're trying to make sure the education funding is fair. The governor's plan has some cuts. We're looking at those cuts. We're trying to make sure that any cuts that we're going to do is not necessarily a certain percentage across the board, which some people suggest is the best, fairest way of doing cuts, but sometimes that doesn't work so well. Targeted cuts are much better. And now in the putbacks, or how the money is taken out of education, there's already a lot of grumbling going on because they say they're taking the most out of the districts that are high wealth and the least out of the districts that are low wealth. Now, we're looking at that. We're trying to see how that works, how our districts are affected. But I know that pretty much all the districts that I represent are cut. And the percentage they're cut is a difficult thing for them, and the fear we always have in the legislature when a governor proposes major cuts in education is that if we don't provide the money from Albany, then they turn around and raise property taxes. And as we hear from our constituents daily, nothing is more unpleasant to them than property tax increases. And the only property tax that we directly affect sometimes is the school tax. In years when we cut school aid, because then they turn around and they make some cuts, and then they also raise property taxes. And we try to do everything we can to stop property taxes. But we'll be looking at the cuts, seeing what we can do to adjust them, trying to make them as fair as possible if there are cuts, and trying to make the cuts something that the schools can live without going to the property tax base.
Lily from Amherst is a UB student, and she wants to know what you're doing to make sure TAP isn't cut.
We're working hard on trying to put the money back into TAP. It's a $75 per student cut. It's not a large amount of money, so we're trying to find another spot in the budget that we can take that money out and then replace the TAP cut with that other cut. So we don't have the specific cut we're going to do for that yet, but I know in talking to a lot of members from every part of the legislature, meaning Senate minority, Senate majority, Assembly minority, Assembly majority, everybody is trying to look for a way to replace the TAP cuts that the governor put in his budget.
Okay, and you know, advancements in higher education is not only a down payment on the students' future, but New York as well, because you'll have a skilled workforce. So.
Well, it's a win-win for everybody, not only the students that are getting the education, but also the employers that are in New York. They get a better educated workforce, and for the amount of money we put in, and actually in this case, for the amount of money we're saving doing this cut, it almost doesn't seem worth doing.
And Jim in Hamburg wants to know why you're taking away the snowmobile trail funds and putting them in the general fund.
Well, quite frankly, I'm not taking away any snowmobile funds. The governor has proposed taking away snowmobile funds. We're trying to fight that. We're trying to show the governor that the snowmobile funding comes from the license fees that snowmobile owners pay and their registration fees, and we believe that snowmobile funding is very important because that industry brings a lot of money into the state of New York. Not only the money they pay for the registration fee that goes into making up the fund, but also people that come to New York to snowmobiles, they spend money on refreshments, they spend money on food and lodging, and it's a revenue generator for the state through all the sales tax that it also gains. So we're trying our best to find a different cut that will keep that money in there and I want to be really clear about that. That's the governor's idea, cutting snowmobile funding. I've been one of the biggest proponents of snowmobiles and snowmobilers because I see the value in it. I see the value that they bring as a tourism attraction and as a recreation outlet for a lot of people that have a great deal of fun with that. And it also brings a lot of money to the state because they all eat and drink and spend a lot of money, and that gets us a lot of sales tax.
There was a similar situation in last year's budget with the snowmobile fund, wasn't there?
Yes, there was, and we're going to try to make sure that we keep this money in the budget. But to be quite clear, it's the governor's proposal, it's not the legislature's, and we're going to try to make sure that gets out of there.
Okay, so how many people are actually involved in making the budget? Is it really just three men in a room?
No, there's three people that negotiate. Everybody works in a workplace where, well, maybe not everybody, but most people work in a workplace where there's a union and there's a management, and the whole union doesn't go into the room to negotiate. When our leader goes to meet with the leaders of the other conference, he already knows what we believe in our conference. We have conversations on every part of the budget. The chairman of the committees make a presentation working with their staff. They go through their area of the budget. They bring back what they think is a good presentation. Other members will ask for certain, they'll say, well, I'm really interested in this part of your area of the budget. Is there any way we can make sure this funding stays? And we work through those things, and we all try to get the best handle on the area we're dealing with. In my case, it's small business, economic development. And we try to see what we can keep and maybe there's areas that we don't know that we don't think work as well as they should be, and that's where we'll look to take money out and put it into areas that we think work better. So everybody's doing that. So it's not three men in a room. And unfortunately, last year, because of the time frame and with the transition, we didn't have a chance to do conference committees. But this year, we're looking forward to doing conference committees, having everybody's input in public meetings. As there are conference committees set up to deal with the budget. And so we'll have a open, frank discussion on all the various parts of the budget, and so everyone will be able to watch that if they choose to. And hopefully we'll come up with a budget that will take what we have in the governor's package, hopefully make it better and make it more palatable for the people in the state of New York.
Okay. So Glenn says, I know there are built-in costs, but why can't we just trim the budget by 10%?
Well, because when you do a 10% across-the-board cut, sometimes you are left with choices that aren't really good choices. It is better to take an amount of money you want to cut out of the budget and go across and find areas that you can cut without causing a lot of damage or without destroying a possible revenue maker for the state. And by revenue maker, I can give you an example of my area. If there's programs that are going to help create jobs that are going to then bring money to the state and also give jobs to the people that are in the state, if we just did a 10% cut across the board, we may hurt those programs and lessen our ability to help small businesses grow. In this case, we have a new fund that helps small businesses get capital, which is their biggest problem, they say. And so we wouldn't want to see those things lowered 10% just because we're doing 10% across the board. And I think it's specific targeted cuts work much better. It's better to say we want to cut this much money out and then go ahead and try to get to that number through specific targeted cuts rather than a 10% across the board. I think that's just an easy way to look at it, but it doesn't work well.
Okay. These questions are really just pouring in. There are a few that want to know about how you feel about the parks closing.
Well, I think it's not a good idea. No governor in the history of state has ever closed parks. It's not a large amount of money. Parks bring in revenue. When people are financially troubled, they sometimes will use the parks more than at other times because it's an inexpensive way to go and get recreation. A lot of parks are, you know, summer-based parks, while others are used all year round, and some are actually more used in the wintertime. So we think that the parks closure is not a great idea. There's also a problem in that some of the employees at the parks, when they agreed to be in Tier 5, the governor had made an agreement with them that there would be no layoffs. So where is the savings if we're closing the park and all the workers are still working? So what workers we know definitely wouldn't be working is if they're seasonal workers. They wouldn't be hired. But we think it's a big risk closing parks. We think it's an added expense. There could be damage because the parks closed, and that would cost money. But the bottom line is most parks are revenue. They bring some revenue in. They may not bring enough in to pay for themselves, but they do bring revenue in. So, and they're usually used a lot by the people that live in that area. And if they're larger parks and have like camping sites, they're used by people not only from our state, but from out of state, that pay to use those camping sites, and some of those are year-round. So we don't think it's a great idea closing parks. Why that came in the last minute, I don't know, but it's not a large amount of money, and we're going to try to find somewhere else to take that money from.
Right, yeah, and it is a very inexpensive family vacation, and you
exactly.
know, to go visit historic sites, it brings money into the town.
Exactly.
Right. Okay, so another one would be, do you agree that the budget cuts should be made in healthcare and education, and what are the effects on my property taxes?
Well, your property taxes and healthcare are two different areas, and so I don't know the connection there. I know, as I said earlier, that we worry oftentimes when we're cutting in education that the net result will be increase in your property tax. So we're trying to stay cognizant of that. We're trying to find areas where we can cut, and why people always talk about healthcare and education as the prime areas to cut is because that's where most of the money is.
Right.
So it's like Willie Sutton, why do you rob banks? Because that's where the money is. So we are looking at that. We're concerned about hospitals and nursing homes because they've taken so many cuts in the last few years that we're now talking about losing the delivery of services to patients. And that's a concern. And last year, after the deficit reduction, we've had some nursing home closures out my way, and we're concerned about more of them closing. And what are we going to do with the people that are living there? Because they have to be placed someplace. So we're looking at those areas. We're trying to find ways of doing cuts, or at least holding down the growth. And so by that way, saving money without damaging the services provided to the people that need them. So it's a tricky situation. It's one of the more complicated things we'll have to deal with in this budget. But we're looking at it and trying to stay cognizant that what little effect we do have on property taxes, because most property taxes are local taxes, we will try to do our best to make sure the state's not causing the property taxes to go up.
All right, and the STAR rebate checks were taken out of the budget last year. Do you think that there's any way that that could be coming back?
Well, we're looking at that, and the misconception last year was that the legislature took the STAR checks away. The fact is that and some people said you took the whole STAR program. Well, the STAR program is still intact.
Right.
And we did keep the STAR program intact. There's a lot of, as a matter of fact, we took some of the part of the STAR program that the governor did cut out and put it back in. But we didn't have the $2.4 billion that would have taken to give back the STAR checks and the program that went along with it in the city of New York. So we're looking at ways to try to do a STAR check, if nothing else, for senior citizens, because they seem to be the ones that would probably need it the most. And that's a little less money than that is. And if we can come up with that money, then we would probably try to do that check again. But last year, we just couldn't come up with the money necessary to put the check back in after the governor took it out. And in his budget last year, it wasn't there. Mm-hmm. So, and there also were some other cuts to the program. We were able to fund the other cuts to the program, but we could not come up, as I said, with the $2.4 billion it would have cost to put the checks back in. As hard as we tried to do that, we couldn't find that many resources. So we're still looking. We're trying to find a way to at least do a smaller version that gets money back to the property tax owner, and we'll continue to do that through this budget process.
All right, and as you said, the basic STAR and the enhanced STAR for seniors remained intact in the last budget. Do you see that staying this
year? Well, that's still in, and we're just going to try to make sure it stays in, because it's important that people, you know, some people might not have even gone to sign up for their STAR again, because they thought, because they didn't get the check, they weren't going to get any STAR program, and they still got money off their property taxes.
Okay, so there are some more questions coming in. What is the senator's plan, given the severe budget constraints for this year, to create jobs here in Western New York?
Well, we have we're looking at what is going to be the replacement for the Empire Zone program, whether it's going to be a different form of the Empire Zone program or if it's going to be the Excelsior Job program that the governor put forward. That is to attract new businesses and help companies grow. And the Excelsior program has a three-prong system, but it's all based on creating 50 jobs over the next 5 years, which is 10 jobs a year. But there's also be a benefit for research and development, and it'll be a benefit for capital investment. Somewhere through this process, we're going to land in what we're going to have as the program going forward. There's also a small business fund that will hopefully create jobs by getting capital available to small businesses who will then maybe hire more people. And because it seems like small businesses are the ones hiring people, the state just stepped forward a week ago and came up with $7 million for GM to help them win the battle of building the new V4 engine in the Tonawanda plant, and that's going to bring something like 400 people back to work there. 300 of them are laid off now, and it means there are probably going to be 100 new jobs. So that's important. There's some venture capital money that's going to be available, and there's a few other pots, and there's some other things we're working on, and we're not quite finished yet, so I don't want to talk about them, but part of that budget process is going to be negotiating with the Assembly and the Governor on putting together the major part of what our economic development program will be. But there are new pots of money, because you can't just cut your way back to fiscal viability. You still have to grow jobs and get people back to work. And we are trying to do that in this budget, even with the fiscal restraints that we have.
Great. What type of Power for Jobs program are you currently in this year's proposed budget?
Well, we just repassed Power for Jobs last year. We're trying to get that to a long-term program so that businesses can plan. One of the problems with the Power for Jobs program has been, and it's a common complaint, that we don't have it last long enough so that people can't plan and make a major investment. So we're still negotiating with all the parties, the governor and the assembly, to try to get Power for Jobs a longer-term program so that we can not only create new jobs but keep the jobs, the good-paying jobs that are currently in Western New York based on the Power for Jobs program. So that continues. We passed Power for Jobs last year. We'll continue to work on it and try to give it a longer life so that businesses can plan, and not only can we retain the jobs we have, but we can make them grow.
Where do you stand on allowing grocery stores to sell wine?
Well, currently I'm not in favor of that. I think that it doesn't bring anything to the table that helps the wineries in New York. I know the common argument is that there's a lot of wineries that think it's a great idea and that they'll be able to make more wine. I happen to believe that the last store on Main Street, the liquor stores serve a real purpose. I think that we would lose liquor stores. We would lose jobs from liquor stores. In that proposal, it says you could now sell to restaurants. Well, if we sell wine to restaurants at any kind of major level, well then, how do we collect the sales tax on the wine that they sell out of the restaurants that they bought from the liquor stores? That's one of the reasons they don't let restaurants buy liquor and wine from liquor stores now, because they can't keep track of it. So that proposal, I think, has a lot of problems. I'm a big proponent of the small businessman, the little liquor store owner, and those employees that work so hard to keep their jobs in those liquor stores. I don't know that if the supermarkets get the liquor licenses, other than the one shot, and it's a one shot over 2 years, after that money's gone, there will probably be a loss in that area. So that, and they would not hire any more people. They're going to use the people that work in that supermarket now. And in the New York wines that say they're going to grow, they're going to have them on the shelf to start, but the way supermarkets work, it's what's selling, it's what stays on the shelf. And it wouldn't be long before the popular, cheaper brands would be taking the shelf space and the New York wines would be pushed in the side, I think. Because although I think they're very good wines and they're well made, they struggle to get people to buy them. In areas where they're not located now in the wine country, like around the Finger Lakes, people are familiar with their wines, they love their wines, they buy them all the time, but in areas where they're not as well known, it's the work of the guy at the liquor store that promotes that wine and gets people to try it and buy it. So I don't know that you'd get that same effort from a supermarket.
Another message just came in today from Google Voice, and This person would like to know if money's been allocated in the state's current budget for the Peace Bridge expansion project in Buffalo, and if so, how much, and also include any funding for the project from his district, your district.
There's that project's a major capital project. There's been money for that in the state budget that carries over, but that also is going to take a lot of federal money, and then the bridge authority itself has money for that project. And until they're ready to do it, I can't tell you what the amount of money is. I can't tell you what it's going to cost to do a bridge. They're still working on that. And until they have a final plan on what the bridge design is going to be, you won't know what the cost is.
Okay. Will the senator supply any funding for the project from his district? It might have been in relation to the expansion project. So we'll move on to the next question. Can you explain how federal stimulus money will be used in this budget?
Well, the growth in the budget this year, and there is growth in the budget, is mostly stimulus money again. There's FMAP money, there's education money, there's some other funds. Some new funds are coming. And now I just saw Washington pass the employment bill that also includes some more stimulus money. So the interesting thing about the stimulus money that I think is a lot of the people out in the audience don't understand is a lot of this money has a lot of strings attached to it. And it's specifically designed to be spent a certain way on specific programs. So it's not just the federal money comes and you spend it any way you want. If there's education money that has to be spent on education. In order to spend that education money, you have to at least match the 2008 levels that the state spend on education. So that's one source. There's highway money that has to be spent on a certain way in highways, and last year's was all spend it or lose it, most of it. We're hoping that I see in this new project bill that passed in Washington, there's supposed to be some money for capital projects, and I believe highway projects would be some of them. Hopefully then we can create more jobs in the construction industry by doing bigger projects. When it's spend it or lose it, it usually ends up what they call in the highway industry mill and fill projects, which doesn't include a lot of hiring. It's just a small crew with big machines that they tear the pavement up, they roll the new asphalt out, and not a lot of workers. So we're hoping that with the new stimulus money and then with the money that's now coming in, and some things are just going online. Some of the green energy things are just being put out. The rail money just came, and there should be jobs created from that. And there's some other programs, clean water and some other ones, that money is just starting to flow because they were so slow in getting the RFPs put together. And that means that the details of what you have to do to get to use that money.
Great. All right, so here is another question. You're getting a lot of participation. This is really great. How do you feel about making Dingus Day a statewide holiday?
I think I'm afraid that if you're not from Buffalo, you might not even know what Dingus Day is. But being from Buffalo, it's a big day. It's the day after Easter. It's Monday. And it's a big celebration in the Polish community. And as in Buffalo, everybody becomes Irish on St. Patrick's Day, and pretty much every place. In Buffalo, on Dingus Day, everybody's in the Polish community. And there's these parties with all kinds of food and a lot of beverages and ethnic music. And in the case now in the east side of Buffalo, they now have a parade. And it's a major feast after Easter. And it's because of all through Easter, everybody had given things up or tried to be more conservative in their lifestyle leading up to the Easter holidays. Dingus Day is a very big day in Buffalo, and I can understand why somebody from Buffalo would call in or write in and say that should be a statewide holiday. I happen to agree with them, and if anybody comes to Buffalo for the first time and takes part in a Dingus Day holiday, they would say the same thing.
What month is Dingus Day?
Dingus Day is never on a certain, it's either in March or April, depends when Easter is. It's a Monday after Easter. And they also celebrate it in Detroit, by the way. Yeah, wherever there's a large Polish community, they celebrate Dingus Day.
Okay. Says that this person, Andrew, says that he thinks that this forum is a really great idea, and he's sorry that you had to stay in Albany so long, but your dedication is really important, and the people of New York thank you. So that wasn't really a question. That was very nice.
Thank you.
Okay, so now he has this question. Do you think that we should be expanding transportation infrastructure like the light rail in the budget?
Absolutely. I think, with light rail, we can't do state alone. Hopefully someday when rail money continues out of the federal government, there will be money for light rail expansion, because the original plan when they did that short rail that they did in Buffalo that runs on from the HSBC arena now to the UB Main Street campus was supposed to be a continuation of federal funding, so that they would have had a spur running into Tonawanda, another spur running up to the Amherst campus, and another spur running to the airport, bringing people in all the way to downtown Buffalo, and one last spur going down to South Towns. And that was the original plan, but the federal government changed directions shortly after the first part of the rail got finished, so that on state funds alone, it would have been prohibitively expensive to build it. So we're hoping someday that the federal government will continue to look at rail and mass transit possibilities, and at that point we can revisit those various spurs and make it a much better system and make it easier for people to get in and out of Buffalo and not have to necessarily drive your car all the time. You can get on the transit, do it cheaper and quicker, and not worrying about parking and all of those things. So I think it's a great question. I hope that someday we'll be able to do it. But the current rail program that the federal government is funding would be for high-speed rail. And for those people that have to go from Buffalo to Albany, they know that it would be a lot easier on a train that got here in less than 5 hours and 20 minutes, which the train now takes. That's without any problems. Sometimes it takes more. Somebody came yesterday on a train, and because of a tree that was down on the track and some other things that happened, it took them roughly 13 hours to get here. That happens. I mean, sometimes if you fly, it takes forever because the planes get canceled. They bounce you to another flight. And as it is, nowadays when you fly, you have to get there 2 hours ahead. Your flight takes an hour, it's 3 hours. So if it's 3 hours on a rapid train, you probably would do it, because you can get up, you can walk around, you can have something to eat. I think it'd be highly successful, and we're looking forward to the day that we can get that rapid rail going across the state of New York.
What are your thoughts on any other infrastructure like broadband?
Well, we're trying to have a broadband program. Unfortunately, we faced a major setback last time when we started out on that, because the company that won the bid on broadband proved that they couldn't do it as we were starting to try to install it. So I think they will be eventually rebidding that, trying to move forward with that, because we think we need to get broadband all over the state. There's a lot of areas that don't have it. The Adirondacks is a glaring area that I've already been at an event where there were eight people standing at a golf tee, all with cell phones, a lot of us with different companies, and nobody had reception. And there's been accidents on the Northway where the person went off the road, they had a cell phone, they couldn't call anybody. And you couldn't see them because they were off the road into a wooded area, and they almost had a tragic event out of it. So that area needs to get broadband into it all the way up quicker. And all across the state, everybody would benefit with a real broadband installation. And we have not given that up as a priority in the state, and we continue to try to work towards that.
Yeah, that's a very important business tool as well.
Yes, it is.
Okay, from Barb, how can we control the Medicaid program, and don't you think we spend way too much money on this?
We spend a lot of money on Medicaid. New York has put a lot of programs into Medicaid. Two of the more popular ones currently that sometimes people forget are Medicaid-based programs are Child Health Plus and Family Health Plus. And the Family Health Plus now is expanded and people can buy into it, so that people entirely forget that it's basically a Medicaid-based program. And Child Health Plus gets children coverage that they didn't have. And if they don't have that coverage, they will go into the bad debt and charity pool, and the people would bring their children to the emergency room, and nothing costs more than medical care given in an emergency room. So those programs save money, and part of the money is then paid by the federal government. And some people would say then, well, we're still taxpayers, we pay federal taxes, and you're still using our tax money. Well, the reality on that part is, though, and the fact is that New York pays billions of dollars more to federal government in all funds than we get back. So that when we can get the federal government to pay 50% of some of these programs, it's a good investment on our part. Should we be stemming the growth of Medicaid? Absolutely. We should work hard to try to stop it from growing as fast as it is. I think there's misinformation, but the fact is it is still a costly program, and we should look to ways to cut down on the program and actually spend the money better to follow the patient, not necessarily to just fund the institutions.
Okay. Someone wants to know if we're going to have to buy new license plates this year, or if it's dead.
Right now, we're working on making sure that stays dead. We got an agreement with the governor late last year that even though it was in last year's budget, that we would not move forward with that. I think there's going to be new license plates. What we're trying to do is make sure it's not that increased fee that he wanted to do last year. So we're still working under the assumption that that's dead. In case it pops up and it's not, then we'll try to find a way to cover that with a different cut in a different area of the budget, because we did not think that was a good idea.
A businessman wants to know why you keep nickeling, diming, no more fees, because it's impossible to own a small business.
We had a small business task force last year that the governor convened, and I was fortunate enough to be a member of it, and we took into account all the various problems that small businesses had. And we're trying to stop any new fees and taxes, and that was part of the conversation on the soda tax earlier. And we don't like the idea of continuing growth of fees. We're trying to get a handle on that. We're also trying to cut down on the paperwork that businesses have to do, and we're trying to make sure that they have capital available. So we know that the problems are there. We're trying to deal with them, and we're trying to make sure that they don't have any new fees or taxes.
Okay. This next question is, in your opinion, how important will the variable tuition aspect of your UB 2020 bill benefit not only UB, but also the entire SUNY system?
Well, in the new program, we passed, there was a UB 2020 bill last year that was in the Senate and the Assembly. In the Senate, we passed that bill. I was able to get the bill passed. We got great cooperation from members on the other side of the aisle, and passed it with 40-some votes. Up until then, UB 2020 was just conversation. By passing it, we got the university system looking at it, and we got the governor looking at it. The governor has put a program in the budget that's called SUNY Innovation Program. It has all the elements of UB 2020. We believe that the tuition policy will be terrific. As I mentioned earlier, for the first time, all the tuition that's raised will go back to the campus, and they'll be in control of that money, and it will serve them better, and their fees will stay at the campus. And so that they'll be able to deal better with their expenses. So I think it's a win-win. I think, and again, that pot of money for people that might not be able to afford their education, if not for that, will be there to help make sure that people aren't left out just because they don't have enough money.
Right. Okay, this next question is, what do you think of the upstate-downstate divide? There are obviously two separate mindsets between the regions.
Well, I think the biggest problem we have is that once again, the media seems fixated on the fact that it's convenient to say, well, we should get rid of New York City. They spend all this money, but they still pay most of the taxes. The downstate area is generating most of the money still. The upstate economy has never taken off in a position to generate enough money so that if we were in that position, we wouldn't have the deficit that we have now when Wall Street took the hits that they took and the financial industry took the hits that they took. So what we're trying to do in the economic development policy is grow the upstate economy so that if ever we are faced with a situation where the financial engine that New York City is has a downturn, we're able to keep going because the upstate economy is going to carry them along instead of just downstate always carrying us along. And same as the state pays more money to the federal government than they get back in all funds, New York City and downstate pays more money to the state in taxes than they get back in all funds. So it's a popular thing to say, oh, we can't afford New York City, but they pay a lot of the taxes. And do we have different ideas on a lot of things? Yes, but that's what makes the state interesting. All the areas of the state are different, they're diverse, and they all bring something to the table. And I think that's one of the things that makes New York so great, is that we have so many different areas. And I think instead of worrying about what can we do to get rid of the people we don't agree with us, it should be what do we have in common with them and that we can work together to make New York a better place.
Great answer. Okay, this next question came from an email. And this person wants to know what type of incentives are companies such as GM receiving to bring business to the state.
Well, GM in this case got a $7 million to help them do the renovations to the plant and the upgrading to the lines that were necessary to win that competition with the other GM plants around across the country and around the world to develop this new engine. And when you can bring in 400 jobs like those GM jobs, it's a really big win for our community. So that kind of incentive, I think, is a great, the ability to do that kind of incentive to let GM, the Tonawanda GM plant, win that competition and provide those jobs to our community and ensure the long-distance health of that plant, meaning that it's no longer on the possible closed list. It's now one of the plants that should grow and have a longer life. It's a win-win for the state and for the people that live there because they get the jobs.
All right, I can almost not believe it. It is time for the last question.
Okay.
So this one is coming from Shane. Your colleague, Senator Liz Krueger, suggested today that Lieutenant Governor Ravitch should take over budget negotiations with the legislature. Do you agree? Why or why not?
Well, Mr. Ravitch is a very successful businessman. He would be a terrific negotiator. Why Senator Krueger said that, I don't know. I haven't seen that release. I was in different meetings all day, meeting with people that have other problems with the state and actually meeting on some economic development things. So meeting with the farm industry and going over the fact that in New York State we have the most clinical trials. We're in the top five in the whole country, that biotech companies are growing as a result of investment by pharmaceuticals, and that medical instrument companies are locating in New York because of that same thing. And things are spinning off our Center for Excellence and research facilities. So I was busy doing that, not worried about who's negotiating the budget for the executive side. I would imagine that it had to do with some other things that are going on now in the executive side, but Mr. Ravitch is a very good businessman. I know he's a close friend of Senator Krueger, and maybe that would make her a lot more comfortable, and maybe that's why she asked for that. But, you know, whether he's negotiating or we're negotiating with the governor or one of his representatives, just so the negotiations move forward, we get this budget in a fashion that's the best for the people of the state of New York with no new expenses and better programs and programs that will deliver the best services to the people in the state and provide the best opportunity to grow jobs now as well as develop a long-term structure for continuing to grow jobs and keep them here, then that's the right budget to do, and it doesn't matter who we're negotiating with.
Right. Seems like there's a really good opportunity in your district to revitalize business and downtown Buffalo coming up, the Powder Keg Winter Festival.
We have a great winter festival that's coming up. There's some really enthusiastic young people that are involved, and they come up with great ideas, and they came up with another one. And they're shutting down part of downtown. They're setting up this winter festival. It's all free. It's Saturday and Sunday this weekend. For the first time ever, the exit ramp from the Skyway on Seneca Street that runs next to the Pearl Street Grill is going to be available for snow tubing. That's one of the features. They're going to have all kinds of interactive things for people to participate in. Everything's free. One of the largest ice mazes ever built is going to be built in front of the HSBC building for people to go through. That's also free, and it should be a wonderful family fun kind of weekend. Hope everybody comes downtown to participate. You know, when you have winters like we have in Buffalo, and everybody's always saying, oh God, how do you live in Buffalo? It's wintertime. We should come up with more ideas like this, and I congratulate the committee that put this together. We're glad we had a chance to participate with them in this, in helping them get that ramp closed. And we think it's going to be a great weekend for family fun and for young people to come down and have a good time. And it's a win-win for everybody in Buffalo, and I congratulate that committee on getting this idea, and we hope everybody has a chance to enjoy it.
Thank you so much for being with us, Senator. This has been very insightful.
Thank you.
On behalf of the Senator and I, we thank you so much for participating in this virtual town hall meeting. Your questions were thoughtful, and as legislators are right now trying to make tough and fair decisions when it comes to spending on everything from municipalities, education, you name it, your feedback is very useful to them. This video will be posted on the Senator's website, stachowski.nysenate.gov. And you can also reach out to the Senator through his website or call his office with any additional ideas that you may have. As the Senator just showed us tonight, it really is critical to explore every option to grow New York's economy and invest for a prosperous future. Have a great night.